Music has always been an integral part to the immersion and world building of Star Wars. Today, I'm joined by Gordy Haab, who has become the prominent name of the music behind Star Wars' video games, and most recently scored the critically acclaimed Star Wars Squadrons.
I'm Gordy Haab. I'm the composer for Star Wars Squadron, and this is Soundscape. My work on Star Wars Squadrons was just a direct result of my work on the Battlefront series, because when EA started making Star Wars games,
right,
I was the very fortunate composer that got hired to do Battlefront 1,
right,
and which of course led to Battlefront 2, mm-hmm. and eventually led to Jedi Fallen Order. And so it was just a logical progression to have me work on Star Wars Squadrons as well.
And Squadrons is a little different because it's in space the entire time. You're always right. Flying. So was there something else that you had to consider going into it? Or was this sort of like a, you know, let's just see what the game has to provide?
I approached the music a little differently because I really wanted the music to be from the perspective of what it would feel like, you know, for my 8-year-old self to get to hop into the cockpit of an X-wing and fly it around. That's a completely different approach musically than, say, like a Jedi Fallen Order, which has lots of ups and downs and dynamics and different emotions and this kind of thing. Squadrons was all about excitement and fun. You know, I mean, of course, you know, you're in heated battles and dogfights and that kind of thing, and things will get tense, and you'll have victorious moments and you'll have like losing moments, right, and this kind of thing. And the music obviously follows all those things, but at the core of it, it just needed to be exciting and over the top, and fun,
a bit more bombastic than the regular score.
Exactly.
And this is one of the few times where you really clearly get to play one or two sides, right? You get to be light or dark, or I guess Alliance and Empire. And did you find that was another thing where it's just like, okay, what's this version of it, but the evil side or the Imperial side?
Yeah, so the approach musically for Squadrons was actually, we reduced it to its most simple element, which was light side, dark side.
Right.
You know, Imperial, rebel.
Right.
And so I actually wrote a main theme for Star Wars Squadrons, and then from that main theme I extracted the Rebel theme and the Imperial theme.
Very cool.
So the Imperial theme is just a variation of the main theme, and the Rebel is just a variation of the main theme. That theme needed to tell quite a few things right away. It had to sound exciting. It had to, you know, have that sense of nostalgia and that excitement about jumping into your favorite ship from your favorite movie from when you were a kid and flying around space. It also had to give the impression as though you were playing as Imperial or as you're playing as a Rebel. So it had to have a little darkness to it, but it also had to have some, you know, uplifting, exciting moments. So it's kind of a tall order. It's like, how do you write a theme? And it had to be memorable. It had to be a theme that I could then, like I was saying, do a variation of for Imperial, a variation of for Rebel, and then all of the themes that branch out from there all relating back to that theme. That theme needed to be a strong enough hook that you would remember it so that all those other things would work. Otherwise, all the other things would just be, you know, sort of noodles and noise.
So do you like sit in a room, grab a toy, and start flying it around and humming? Like, how do you get to that?
Yeah, so, you know, in some ways, yes. So I sit at my piano and I look at that blank page of paper, and, you know, after I cry for a couple hours just because I'm so intimidated by the lack of any notes on it, I just start to just write anything.
Right.
Because, you know, I saw this masterclass series where Neil Gaiman, a writer, was talking about his process of writing. And I thought this was a really interesting thing. He said that the best stuff is always version 2 of anything you're writing. Version 1 can be completely thrown away. As long as you have something there on the page, and then you can go in and clean it up and say, well, I like that, I'll keep that. I hate that, let's take that out. Now how do I get from there to there? Okay, I'll make this transition. It's always about editing after the fact. So if I just spill ideas onto the page, and then I go back and look at it and say, okay, what in this is worthy?
I see.
You know, and then I just start pulling those elements and kind of piecing them together to create something new. But if I just try to write the best possible theme right away with a blank page of paper, I can never get started.
Right.
It's so difficult because it's such a daunting task. But if I just pour some ideas out, it might be all terrible. But maybe like 2 or 3 little ideas in there were great. And then I can take those and start to, you know, build off of it. Whenever I can, I always like to get a build of the game because then I need to see how the music is working, not just emotionally, but also technically, you know, interactively. How is the music, you know, does it switch at the right point when you hit this certain trigger in the game? How does that transition feel? So I have to sort of test these things out. And, you know, I usually work with the music director at the developing company pretty closely on these kinds of things. But until you actually implement it into the game and really see how the transitions work and does it feel smooth, you really don't know until it's in there. So I always like to play through the games when I can, which you know, most of the time I'll have a build of the games.
And of course, a lot of players are going to play this game in VR. So did that affect any of the ways and the decisions you made in terms of the music?
It did. I wanted to, because Squadrons is a VR game, or at least has a VR component, I wanted the music to also sort of be immersive. And so we recorded it in a way that it could be like a fully immersive recording. So it's in surround. So when you're playing the game, it's as though you're standing on the conductor's podium in, at Abbey Road, you know, so it's wrapping all around you. So it was musically speaking, I didn't approach it any differently than I would, you know, like a exciting dogfight. Gotcha. But I wanted it to be immersive from an audio perspective as well. And in fact, we even tried to push music more towards the side and back so that the front would be more about your visuals and like actually seeing like diegetic or hearing diegetic sounds that matched the visuals that you're seeing so that the music would be more of kind of like this immersive thing that's happening sort of in, not in the background, but it's because it's not diegetic.
Right.
We wanted it to find its space without getting in the way of all of this stimuli because there's so much going on when you're in VR. You can look up, down, wherever. It's like stimulus everywhere. It's pretty insane. If you were just to hit the player with like, you know, loud, you know, fast paced action music straight through the whole way, it would be, you know, pretty static.
Yeah.
So I always try to find ways to build in little, you know, dips and dives, and maybe it just backs off a little bit and just goes down to just strings for a minute, and then boom, you hit him with the big brass section again, or you know, jump into a completely new key, you know, just on a dime. You know, these kinds of things are really effective in kind of in keeping it interesting, but also when you're playing and you hear these drastic changes and these switches, it creates the effect of, you know, being in a situation where at any moment, the action can change.
Right.
So when you're hearing those things, you're kind of like, you know, kind of on the edge of your seat because you're like, what's going to happen next? I mean, that's what's happening in the game. You don't know what's going to happen next in the game. And also musically, you don't know what's going to happen. So keeping that sort of that interest and keeping the player guessing creates this impression of it being like exciting, fast paced, like, you know, things changing constantly.
And you're also dealing with explosions and blaster sounds. Is there any consideration as to like, well, these live in these frequency areas. Should we not try and overwhelm them with an instrument that gets up there, or should we like work around it so you can always hear the crystal clear blast of a TIE fighter?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, I mean, with the music, I'm always trying to be very conscious of all of the other sounds that are happening within the game. But usually that comes more from a technical side than actually like a composition side. So, you know, I try to, when we mix and deliver the final music to be implemented in the game, I leave music out of the subs, for example, because a lot of the oomph and, you know, it's, and then a big explosion is coming from the sub channel in the audio. So I keep music out of the subs, you know, I keep music out of center channel.
Right.
Because center channel is, you know, that's where all your instructions and your dialogue and, you know, sound
the
effects
gameplay
are really,
parts of it,
exactly. Like all the diegetic stuff is in front of you. So I don't want music to be in front of you. I want music to be around you. So it's more of a technical approach, I think, than anything, particularly with a game like this, you know, something like Jedi Fallen Order, where the music had to emotionally stay out of the way sometimes or swell up, and, you know, so I'm following the storyline a bit more. You know, if it's supposed to be a very tender moment, I might just have like just a couple instruments playing, you know, keep it very intimate. But with Squadrons, it's just action all the time. So, you know, I had to find ways to make sure I wasn't stepping on, you know, the other audio that's happening.
And what needs to happen.
Exactly, you know.
Yeah, that's a fascinating thing to think about, which is, normally in a movie, the movie's doing the speaking and you're watching the scene and the music's adding on to it and music can't be overpowering and all that stuff. In the game, the player is making these conscious decisions all the time. How do you sort of balance the idea that the music is there to complement and help increase and better the experience, but also establish the world, the setting, the mood, and all that, while not taking away from that player freedom that is so important to video games?
Scoring video games has so many unique challenges as opposed to like scoring film or TV. One of which is that you never really know what the actual scene will be like because it's different every single time a player plays it.
Right.
You sort of can't account for, okay, I know in this moment, you know, there's going to be this big thing that happens, so I need the music to duck down and get out of the way. Those things could line up so that there's an explosion right on the big brass chord and everything, you know, it happens at the same time, which is could be ineffective. So musically speaking, I'm always trying to like I was saying before, it's like change quick, move to different sections, modulate, jump around here, because if you keep the music kind of interesting at all time, it almost has this natural ability to hit things that are happening on the screen, even if it wasn't intentional.
Right.
So, and because the player is going to play it differently every time, you want it to feel like it was actually scored to picture. So how do you do that?
Right.
It really comes from jumping around, using odd meters and mixed meters and
interesting
changes in modulations on, really quick modulations, that kind of thing.
Do you listen to other music, watch movies, or is that something you find that might interfere with what you're trying to do?
You know, sometimes I'll watch other films, but I try not to watch, if I'm working on Star Wars, I try not to watch anything to do with Star Wars.
Right.
Because I'm very conscious of not wanting to be influenced by the scores from those films, other than it feeling like what I'm writing fits canon.
Right.
I don't want to imitate. Mm-hmm. I don't want to have something get stuck in my head that I can't get rid of, and I end up like hashing it out in my own music and not even realizing it. So no Star Wars while working on Star Wars projects is sort of my rule.
Yeah.
But I do get inspired by watching other films. I like to listen to styles of music that I'm not writing, and sometimes that'll help a lot. This is something my wife was always telling me. She's like, if you're always listening to symphonic music, then you go write symphonic music. I mean, aren't you just going to end up like rehashing the ideas you just heard? And it's like, that's actually a good point. So now I'll listen to jazz, I'll listen to rock stuff or whatever.
You know?
Anything that's not what I'm working on, I'll listen to that because it's just musically inspiring.
Do you ever feel intimidated that the Star Wars score you make won't be accepted by the wide fandom, or does that not matter to you? Because you know what you're making is genuine.
It matters a lot. Well, I mean, I set out when I first started working on Star Wars games, I set out to write a score that as an uber Star Wars fan, I would be impressed with. That was my goal.
You were your own hardest critic at that point, right?
Yeah. Because I knew that there was a giant fan base, and that was intimidating. But in the way I sort of got through that intimidation level of like knowing there's like 4 billion people out there that might hear this, and you know, if it's not good, then oh no, was to just write something that I liked. Because if I can do that, I'm one of those fans. Right. So, if, you know, that's one down.
Yeah.
You know, 3.99 billion to go. So that's sort of my approach.
Wow. Wow, that's fantastic. I mean, I think you have a long long hyperspace jump of Star Wars projects ahead of you. Is there anything that you want to do desperately that's sort of like this is my dream? You've already achieved your dream in a lot of ways, but what's next?
Yeah, I mean, I have achieved my dream and then some.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's never enough.
Yeah, I mean, artists will always attest to that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I would absolutely love to work on a Star Wars project that wasn't a game.
Yeah,
A film or even one of the TV series. That's something I've been very interested in doing. I do work a lot in film as well, so I still feel like I am connected to that world, which is my first love before I got into games and, you know, found a second love.
Yeah.
To work on one of the films would be pretty amazing.
Well, I will say Star Wars is all about the idea of legacies and passing it on to that next generation. So maybe you're in line.
Perhaps. Time will tell.
Thanks for watching Soundscape. Big shout out to Hollywood Scoring for letting us film on their stages. And let us know in the comments if there's a video game composer that you want to hear from next. See you around.